So my name is Akasajoti, and I'm here in London, UK, speaking to Varadhi all the way from Melbourne, Australia. Mm-hmm. And Varadhi joined the order how many weeks
ago? On the 21st, 28th of March. So what is that? Just a bit over a month ago.
In quite extraordinary circumstances.
Yeah.
How's it been for you landing in the order?
Oh, it's been really, really interesting. It's a great time to be in the order because I feel very connected, even though I'm not spending a lot of time with order members in real time. There's a lot on offer, so that feels really good, actually. Yeah. In a strange way, even though we're isolating, I feel quite connected.
Mm. And this feels like a really lovely opportunity to get to connect with you already.
That's right.
We met how many years ago? Three, maybe?
Yeah, 2017 ago. Or something, yeah.
On a course at Adistana, and I haven't seen you since then, have I?
Not in person.
So, this was like a lovely opportunity to get to connect with you.
Yeah. No, likewise. So
we're here particularly to talk about our favourite Lojong mind training verses. Do you want to tell me which one stood out for you?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to pick a favorite, isn't it? But the one that I thought we can bring in to talk about today is of the two witnesses hold the principal one. And I've heard this one before a few years ago and somebody just kind of said it out of context and that it wasn't a part of the mind training slogans when I heard this. And I thought it's really kind of... made me think, what does that mean, the principal witness, and this whole concept of being witnessed, you know, being observed. And the more I thought about it, I thought, okay, this is kind of about self-awareness, you know, and really kind of knowing what's going on for myself, being aware of that and being a witness to myself, you know. So it brought up a lot of different almost imagery and different kind of points of reflection. And the importance of honesty, I think it's something that it really brings to mind, that at any moment we have to be really honest with ourselves. And that's so important for integration. And the more I kind of think about the spiritual life, I think it's actually about more and more being yourself, you know, kind of letting go of all these ideas of how we need to be or how we need to be seen or, you know. So it really brought up this kind of thing of how can I be the principal witness and what does that mean, you know? And it requires this constant awareness and constant checking in with oneself. And this goes, you know, it's not just about when people, when you're criticized or, you know, it's not just about when you kind of praised. And in both instances, honesty is so important and it's actually often quite difficult, you know. It's something that's it's a practice to actually be able to stop and kind of have a sense of how do I feel about this and what was my intention, you know. I find that the more I practice, the more I become aware of my intentions, and often that's not a very pleasant thing. Sometimes it's like, oh, I could have done that better, you know. But there's a it's empowering to be able to be in that position. So unless I'm willing to kind of see and witness and be the principal witness of my experience, I'm not empowered. I'm empowered to the degree that I can actually do this. And even if it's uncomfortable at times, it's the only way forward, really, turning towards what's happening and accepting and encouraging and taking it all on board, really. Something really empowering about this that I really appreciated when I heard it. Mm.
Could you describe a little bit what the alternative would be? So of the two witnesses, let the principal witness be, what is it? Let the principal witness be...
Hold the principal one.
Mm. So that's, you're describing that as a process of, in a way, like being the witness to your own experience, as opposed to...
relying on praise and blame, for example, you know, or relying on what other people think of you, or relying on these external kind of signs of success and failure and how well you've done ethically, even, you know. you might have a, you know, even I'm thinking of, you know, I might have a problem with somebody in conflict, and I might go and talk to someone, and they might say to me, oh, you haven't done anything wrong, you know, it's completely fine. And I can believe that, you know, which might be the case, but also I need to still go in and think, it might be an inkling, oh, they could have done something better, you know. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I'm the only one who can know my intention, you know, and I need to kind of, I need to hear that and believe that. And that's the principal witness. Otherwise, it's very disempowering. You have to look out all the time around and to kind of get these signs of, am I doing well or not? And, you know, it's very external, outward focused, and there's not much you can do about what other people think anyway, you know. I think that's the, that's something to reflect on for me as well. It's like, how much do I rely on the secondary witness, you know?
Nice question.
Yeah.
When you texted me and said that this was one of the slogans that you might talk about, it reminded me, I really resonate with it. Like, it's an area that I work with quite a lot in my own practice, particularly the sort of tendency to get caught between those two worldly winds of praise and blame, or sort of positive reputation and disrepute. And like how much I'm sort of dependent on the two positive forms of that, the sort of praise and positive reputation.
Yeah.
And really wanting to ground myself in something that isn't based on that kind of affirmation, I suppose. And it reminded me of being at Akasajoti on my ordination retreat. You know, these things can show up coarsely or subtly, like the degree to which we kind of go for refuge to praise or status. But they can also show up, they can also show up subtly. And I remember this instant where we were doing a walking meditation. So I was on a retreat with, say, 20 of us, and we were in the garden doing a walking meditation. And one of the leaders on the retreat, I really cared what she thought of me. And I'd been aware of that dynamic. And then we were doing this walking meditation, and suddenly I just felt really absorbed. Like, I was barefoot walking on this gravel, and it was a very sort of absorbing experience. I noticed that. I noticed the pleasure of that. And then the next thought that arose was, I want this person to see me now. I want them to know how absorbed I am in this walking meditation. What is going on? Like, what am I wanting? And then I heard this voice inside me that was just going, see me, see me. Like, I just wanted to be sort of seen. But in that moment, what was happening was I was having an experience of like depth and still absorption and contact with myself, and then jumping out of it, wanting someone else to witness that experience. Whereas actually what would be needed in that moment would be for me to just witness myself.
So, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Oh, just to have kind of confidence, oh, this is the experience that I'm having.
And
delight in it in a way. Rather than needing more or needing it confirmed in a particular way.
It takes you out of that experience somehow, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
You stop being the person experiencing it. You become something else. Yeah, that's a good example. What was your favorite slogan that you chose today?
My favorite slogan was liberate yourself by examining and analyzing. Liberate yourself by examining and analyzing. And I think this is the other side of that kind of cultivating that kind of confidence in our individuality, and referring to ourselves as the principal witness. Like, I think that to do that is dependent on our capacity to liberate ourselves by examining and analyzing. So like you said, what it requires is just a very high degree of honesty. And what I like about this slogan, liberate yourself by examining and analyzing, is it's like it's an invitation to really really look very truthfully at what's happening inside our mind and just take responsibility for it. And I think what I also like is that there's this sense of welcoming everything. There's no need to have a sort of fear response to what's happening inside our own minds. Like, we're human, we're fallible. There's going to be mixed motivations. I'm going to want to be witnessed by people. I'm going to look outside myself for affirmation. My motivations are going to be mixed. That's okay. What doesn't feel okay to me is when I'm not conscious or not willing to turn towards that, or be let that sort of see the light. If I kind of try and cover it over, that feels to me where I get into sort of tricky ground. Try to conceal my sort of fallibility or weaknesses, where I find it very, very liberating to just be honest. And my experience is that when I sort of really explore a mental state or something that I've done, and I'm able to sort of analyze the different components of that mental state or the different conditions that gave rise to a particular experience or action, somehow bringing more awareness to that, it does then liberate itself. You know, it moves, it changes. Whereas if I'm trying to stop something being the case, it gets stuck. I see this most clearly. I'm in a small group of friends who share with each other about their ethical practice, and kind of go into our ethical practice and explore it, and share about it honestly with each other. And I've recently joined one of these groups just a few weeks ago, and the difference that it's made to my experience just in a few weeks has been so so wonderful. Like, what happens is that it gives me a sense of myself on the path. Allows me to kind of feel confident that I'm on the path and I'm practicing, because there's an acknowledgement of where I'm at, and there's an acknowledgement of where I'm looking towards, or how I want to grow, and both of those things are held in that context. So yeah, liberate yourself by examining and analysing.
No, absolutely, yeah. And I wonder, with this, this talking about ethical practice, there's a sense of continuation there too, and a sense of like, almost relaxing into that. You know, as I was listening to you, it's like a sense of, okay, I can relax into that and know that that is kind of taken care of somehow, you know, because there's a sense of, I am going to look at this, and I am looking at this, and and that's a good thing, you know, like a sense of part of your psyche, part of you just kind of like, okay, that's something that's going to happen anyway, with the continuation of these meetings and the talking of that. Because it's true, the analysis is the key to liberation, isn't it? I mean, it's a lovely, lovely, again, this word empowering comes to mind, but it's like there's something we can do about it, right? There's something we can do about our ethical failings and our, you know, things that we find difficult, whatever is hindering our practice, you know. It's kind of, yeah, you analyze it or you talk about it with a friend, you know, and it's really kind of... it's a bit of a small miracle, really, isn't it? It's like that there are all these tools. It's true that, like, it's like it's all set out, you know. It's like, this is what you do, and when I do it, I agree that it does work, you know. It does work. Turning towards it, I was on a retreat recently, and someone said, yeah, it's the obstacles that are actually the key to our freedom. And I was like, that is just a fact, you know. The only way is to actually turn towards it and kind of like work with it in a kind, not a harsh kind of, you know, combat kind of way, but just like, okay, so this I'm finding difficult, you know, what is that about, you know? And like giving that side, as you were talking, you know, the side that wants that recognition, kind of giving that a hug, you know, and also the higher aspiration of like, may I not need any of this, you know. It's like this rich kind of turning towards that suddenly everything is meaningful, you know, because yeah. more and more of us are here.
Yeah, yeah, lovely. Yeah. That's really, really important to me in my practice, that there isn't any area that is off limits. It's not okay to turn towards. We need to bring all of ourselves.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting as well. What it reminds me of is that there's a particular formulation of the path where freedom from remorse is the first step. And what that's pointing to is that experience of like having a clear conscience is actually that gives rise to joy. Like if we can sort of trust that we're going through the world in a harmless way, then there's much more freedom of energy and joy that is possible to arise. So it's also not a moralistic, it's not a kind of like you say, it's not a kind of critical or moralistic approach. It's actually a sort of liberating, energetic, joyful one.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because you're like, yeah, I'm doing what needs to be done, you know, or I can do what needs to be done. And that's just, there's just so much confidence in there, you know. And then whatever happens is almost irrelevant, because the attitude is one of like, bring it on. Or let me face it, because I feel like I can, you know. Yeah.
I think that's probably a good note to end up bring it on.
Yes. Thank you. What a lovely little conversation. Thanks, Akasajoti. Yeah.
Thank you, Varadhi.